a couple of elements that actually relate to why I'm here. I was the editor of a publication called Ramparts back in the 60s. And in that capacity, while I was there, our major achievement journalistically is we exposed the NSA's use of organizations, cultural organizations, student organizations, and in violation of even then existing law. And so I got into this whole business quite a young age. And because of our exposés and others, during that period, we had the church committee hearings in the mid-70s and got into COINTELPRO and all that. So this is an old story for me in a way. And the other part that was left out is that I worked at the Los Angeles Times for 29 years as a national reporter and as a columnist. So I've been in mass media. And my duties at the Los Angeles Times at one point involved covering the change in regulation for business that Bill Clinton brought about in partnership with Republicans at the Senate, Phil Graham and others, leading to the reversal of the Glass-Steagall Act. That was the subject of my previous book, The Great American Stick-Up. And the Glass-Steagall Act was one of the prize bits of legislation coming out of the New Deal to prevent another depression. And as you know, the reversal of the Glass-Steagall, the Financial Services Modernization Act, as it was called, was an act that allowed banks and insurance companies and commercial banks, investment banks, and so forth, all to merge. And along with the Commodity Futures Modernization Act, which made legal all of these credit default swaps and collateralized debt obligations, we got the Great Recession. But another thing we got from that bipartisan effort that I covered at the time was the ability to merge data. And when this data was being merged, a question came up and a number of people challenged. How can you just do that? People have a policy with Travelers Insurance. They have medical records over there. It's a life insurance company primarily. You're merging it with Citibank and so forth and investment banks and all that. What happens to this data? And so some people, Ed Markey, who's now the junior senator from Massachusetts, I think it's great. I mean, to have two senators like Elizabeth Warren and Ed Markey, fabulous progressives. But Ed Markey was then a member of the House and was very strong on privacy issues. And he and this was always been a bipartisan issue, by the way, and Bill Sapphire, who had been Richard Nixon's chief speechwriter, was by then a columnist at the New York Times. And he also was a privacy advocate, and a number of other people. And they raised a very basic question back then, in the end of the 1990s. They said, if you're merging all this data, people who gave you that data to the insurance company or to the bank or to this or to that didn't intend for it to be shared. And they said that Bill Clinton should veto this piece of legislation, if for no other reason, that there isn't privacy protection in it. That these people signed up and they turned over their most intimate data, and now it's going to be shared, and not just shared with the affiliates, but to third-party people and so forth, and so on. Well, Bill Clinton, and his lack of wisdom or opportunism, refused to do it. I talked to Clinton. I had interviewed him. I talked to him after and over the years about it, and the argument came back from the Clinton people that the banking people said they didn't want these mergers if they couldn't mine the data, okay? And that really told you what the whole economic side of the story is about, which of course continues into the internet age. It's the data that is valuable. And so it would allow them to market. They want to sell you a house. They want to know if you're about to drop dead. They have all this information and so forth and so on, medical and what have you. And they want to know your vulnerabilities, your desires, and everything else. And so the privacy advocates and Sapphire, I never thought I would live to the day where one of the heroes of a book of mine is William Sapphire. But, you know, you got to call him as you see him. And he wrote a brilliant column that were unfortunately ignored, and he made a really compelling point, which remains. If you want the conclusion of this talk, I'll give it to you right now. And they called for opt-in. I said, before you can share data collected in one way, you have to ask people if it's all right to share it, because they didn't give it to their doctor or their insurance appraiser or their mortgage person with the idea of it going somewhere else. And just because you happen to have an affiliate or have done this merger or want to sell it to a third party, it's their data. And there should be an assumption that they retain control over how it's used. And they said that Bill Clinton, the demand was, and Sapphire was quite clear in his columns, he said that Clinton should veto the bill unless that opt-in, meaning, as opposed to the opt-out that you have now, this junk mail you get all the time, which is largely worthless. Opt-out says basically if you have a suspicion something's going on with your mail, because all these ads keep popping on this page, somebody must know. So at first people say, isn't it marvelous? You know, I went to see 50 Shades of Grey, and then I got these advertisements for erotic literature. Yeah. How did they know I care about that moment? You know, oh, well, because somebody has sold that data that you went, and how long you stayed, did you buy the book originally, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What underwear did you buy after, and what email did you write to your lover? All of that's available. They do know everything about you. And what they don't know today, within the next 5 years, they will certainly know. And they will collate it with your DNA and the biometrics and everything else. So we had this prospect back then of the data mining. And they said, well, no, we'll have opt-out. If people complain, they can object, and then if you can run it down and so forth, maybe you can win and they'll clean it up or something, as opposed to opt-in. And opt-in has a great clarity to it. You own the data, you have to give permission, okay? So that's what happened, and Clinton dropped the ball. And there wasn't that much of a discussion, unfortunately. And there were only 8 people in the Senate who voted against that bill that caused all this economic mischief, and privacy didn't rank very high with them. At that time, however, I was still working at the LA Times, but I was also teaching at USC, and in the Annenberg School of Communication Journalism, and I decided then I should start a privacy center, among other things, and didn't really go very far, but I had also had an online journalism thing and all that, and started pursuing it. And I wrote an article for what was then still a print magazine that Yahoo had called Yahoo Internet Life. And it was a cover story for a whole issue on this question. And I think it's quite good work. I'm just trying to show you my original interest. And my whole approach then and now, I have to say very strongly, I am not a Luddite, okay? I am not against technology. I love this new technology. I love the internet. And some of the most powerful critics of what's happening are people who have come from right inside the whole world of the internet. And their concern is this wonderful educational extension, this wonderful means of people communicating throughout the world, okay? And I know this because I've been publishing an internet magazine now for 9 years. I write a lot for the internet and so forth. One of the things about winning these Webbies, you go to all these conventions, you meet people. The last convention, they celebrated Aaron Swartz, one of the great rebels in the internet, and other people. There's a lot of strong feeling within this industry that the thing that's best about it is being undermined, being subverted. Okay, it's the two sides of the coin. And I'm not going to give you the big spiel on the internet, why I think it's the last great hope for meaningful democracy, but just think, we used to live in a world where they thought they had to invent a new language of Esperanto to get people to talk to each other, right? And now I get papers from China that are instantly translated. Not that you shouldn't learn Mandarin. I tried for several years when I was in the Center for Chinese Studies at Cal. But nonetheless, it's incredible. Narda Zucchino, who will not let me introduce her, is my wife. And she's only the only reason she's able to be here is she's unemployed for one of the rare months in her life. She's just finished a marvelous book on California and why California is a lot better place than Texas. You can read it when it comes out. I did want to say something about that and the sort of progressive vision. Driving here, or walking here, we didn't drive, we walked downtown. And my wife will tell you she has a bad back and the hills are awful. But we did walk past the Congregational Church, and there was a sign on there about a living wage. I thought, what a great point to bring up in a talk tonight. Because the Congregational Church, as you know, is the oldest church, really, in the United States, the church, basically, the pilgrims and all that. And the whole idea that out of our original tradition, we still have, you know, in a world of sham religion and hyping and conning and everything else, there's still some folks that care about these essential values, and one of which is that if we don't have pretty much an equal playing field and equal opportunity and so forth, you can't really have a representative government and a representative democracy. And it's so great to be in Seattle, where you actually suddenly, in addition to doing all this stuff with Microsoft and Amazon and everything, you're actually pioneering the whole national debate about minimum wage and living wage. So my hat's off to you in that respect. And I do want to say one other thing. I'm not here to demonize people in the internet industry. I remember once doing a very good interview for Talk Magazine with Bill Gates. And I get run into a lot of trouble in these talks when I say nice things about Google and Microsoft. And you know, the only criticism I have found on the panels that I have with techies is that they agree with me on all my concern, and then they say I'm too kind to Google and Apple and so forth. So I don't want to go too far in that direction. But I remember when I interviewed Gates, and he happened to be a very good moment because he just decided that you should die poor, or not poor, but give away most of it, and I thought that was a good idea. And so we interviewed about that. And then when I got down to Berkeley, there was a party across the street, and I went in, and a great lawyer we have down in Santa Monica, and who's a judge, and what is Earl's second name? Huh?
Johnson.
And Earl Johnson said, oh, where you been? And I was late to the party. He said, oh, I've been to the book. He says, oh, did you meet his father? Great guy. He helped, huh? He said, he helped me start Rural Legal Aid. And I thought, so, you know, the good news here is that even though, yes, we have these centers of enormous wealth and inequality and cynicism and showmanship and exploitation and all the things that depress the hell out of us, deep down in our being and in our tradition, there's a desire to do the right thing. And there's a desire to live meaningful lives and care about what happens to other people. And in writing this book, I have become kind of a super patriot. And in fact, in the review of my book in the LA Times, they said I wax on too much about the founders or so forth. And I know that they were flawed. And I know that there were limits to what was happening with our experiment in representative republic. I know we all know the limitations. We all know it was primarily for white males. We all know, you know, there was a bias towards property. We all know there was slavery. So I'm not going to, you know, I've read Howard Zinn also. So, but there is a brilliance to our founding document. An absolute brilliance. And it's not that the people around the world didn't have this idea, not that it never came up before, but it was stated with a clarity and a centrality to it that no other society has. And that was that you cannot have representative governance without respecting the sovereignty of the individual. It was that clearly stated, okay? And that the individual cedes power to state agencies. If you read Confucius about morality, it's the other way around. You know, how do we better serve an emperor? Even Aristotle gets a little confused on this question. But our founders had basically two ideas in mind that really have to, I think, be recalled. And there was a really widespread agreement on them. One is you can't be a republic and an empire. If they tried, one of the great mysteries in there is this, how did England go wrong? How did France go wrong? How did Spain? Well, most importantly, how did Rome go wrong? And to be crude about it, it was the shift from republic to empire in the case of Rome. And if you're going to build an empire, and you're going to meddle and get in entanglements and everything, and for those of you who want the finest sentence on the subject of all is George Washington's farewell address, where George Washington warned about the impostures of pretended patriotism, okay? And they were very clear on this, because in war, truth is the first casualty. If you build empires, you get involved everywhere, you're going to lose this whole basic respect for the people and their being able to govern themselves, and they're going to be lied to and deceived and so forth. That's number one. Number two was the idea that even under the best of circumstances, power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And that you can't trust even yourself with this kind of power. So they gave us a constitution that had checks and balances, separation of powers, only cedes power to the national specifically, and then even to the state, and that it stays with the individual. I bring this up now, you know, I go to a lot of, sorry to say, Laker games and Raider games and everything, and I'm always amazed. We're singing the national anthem, which is really pretty banal in a way, and, you know, but you feel that little feeling of patriotism, I think. And then I think, well, why do we forget the basic lesson? And the basic lesson was these guys, and unfortunately they were guys, who were about to give us this government, put in restrictions on what that government can do. Okay? The government that they were going to be. And they put that Fourth Amendment. They put the First Amendment. They put due process. They put self-incrimination. Okay? And in this basic structure of the document, not just the Bill of Rights, they put in, as I said before, separation of powers, checks and balances, and so forth. All of these restraints. These were not restraints. Now, the restraints, particularly the Fourth Amendment, comes from English common law. Goes back to the Magna Carta, you know? Even the King of England did not have the right to invade the hut of the poorest person. Okay? Could not rummage about in that hut without specific reason, a specific target of what they were looking for, or it was in violation of that peasant's human rights. Okay? That became our Fourth Amendment. But it was also, as Chief Justice Roberts pointed out in a critical decision last June, in a unanimous Supreme Court decision, that Fourth Amendment, that spirit of the Fourth Amendment, was actually the spark that started the American Revolution. Right? It was a trial of Otis. John Adams was taking notes, wrote about it, and he said that was the moment, the spark of the American Revolution, the searches of the king, the agent of the king, and the fishing expedition, the looking for people being, you know, the observed society. And so while the Constitution does not use, I pointed out to our great group here locally that we're going to have discussion with, the Seattle Privacy Coalition. The word privacy, yes, does not appear in the Constitution. Something much more significant idea does, and that's individual sovereignty. The right, the sacred rights of the individual. That the individual is the center of power, legitimately. And so this notion of, I usually carry around my, oh shoot. Does somebody have the Fourth Amendment handy? Huh? It's in the book? Well, I'm not going to read it. But it's a very, do you guys have it back there? Can you recite it from memory? No? Okay, I'll get it when we have our discussion after. I don't know, how did I let that slip away? But anyway, the clarity of it, that you cannot do the very thing that our government now claims to do. And the reason the Supreme Court decision was so important, it was limited because they didn't apply to everything else, but they applied it to something I read about in the New York Times today. Did anybody read that story about the Harris Company and gathering cell phone tower information by pretending you're a cell phone tower? Okay, it's an incredible story. Let me just wander off a little bit because I took some notes so I wouldn't blow it. But in that story today, and this concerns the Stingray program. Okay, it's a front page story in the New York Times. And at any rate, all these police agencies are able to pretend they're cell phone towers. And they're going after a bad guy. They're always going after a bad guy. And they gather all this information of everybody's in the area. Your emails, your chats, your everything you're doing. They have it. Okay. Now that is a general warrant search. That's clearly a violation of the Fourth Amendment. Clearly a violation of the spirit of our Constitution. They're gathering information on people they don't even know. They have no right, no suspicion, no warrant, no specific cause, or anything. Now, that is not what makes it so ominous, or the story. What makes it so ominous is that political units that we ostensibly elect. In this case, believe it or not, it was right in the heart of Silicon Valley, Santa Clara. The supervisor objected. Why are we spending, I think that moment it was $500,000 or something. Why are we buying this equipment when we're not allowed to talk about it? The police, all the sheriff, everybody has to sign a non-disclosure agreement. The same one they do, people get signed non-disclosures when they work on Mark Zuckerberg's house, or Larry Ellison's house, and we can't talk about any of this, how the beams are joined or anything else. Everybody's for privacy when it's about their own privacy, and get over it for yourself. And so here's this case where this one lone supervisor right in the heart of Silicon Valley says, why am I voting for a system, the Stingray box that can grab and pretend to be a cell phone tower, when I can't even discuss it, when the sheriff can't talk to us about it, when nobody will tell us what it is, and the company is being protected, you know, by the FBI. The FBI is enforcing these non-disclosure agreements. The FBI will come after you if you talk about this private company called the Harris Company. And so this supervisor, who was the one person who voted against it, will be in trouble if he can get somebody to talk about it. Then he'll be like Edward Snowden. He'll be a whistleblower. Okay? This is absolutely bizarre. I read that story, I don't know, 20 times this morning. This is, and I knew about Stingray. I knew that, you know? But I mean, my God, what an example. And I could take you down the list. The private-public partnership in this, in which a cloak of secrecy has been put over private companies, okay, enforced by our the people who can knock on your door and arrest you and throw away the key, you know? But take Palantir. You ever hear of Palantir? Oh, the local privacy group. Huh? Oh, they have an office here, okay. Well, okay, so Palantir is a company quite formed by a couple of PayPal folks, Peter Thiel and a colleague, and his colleague, I don't like to, you know, people are innocent until proven guilty, and I'm all for that. But his partner and was the subject of another New York Times story about 4 weeks ago about the mentor and the mentee at Stanford. And just to cut to the short of it, she's suing him in a civil suit and alleging, among other things, rape. And Stanford has banned this fella from being on the Stanford campus for the next 10 years. Now, this fellow who's banned from being on the Stanford campus for the next 10 years is nonetheless a founder of this company called Palantir. He's one of the PayPal people. And so he can't go on the Stanford campus, but he's a major investor and participant in a company that has had access to the CIA's data, or the data of all of our intelligence agencies, the Los Angeles Police Department, the New Orleans Police Department. You go down the list. They are the main data mining company, privately held. Okay, not traded on the market. You can't ask all kinds of questions about it. And they are trusted with this data. And there's no adult supervision. There's nobody we elect that can go into it. Okay, so Palantir is a good example of a company. It's discussed in my book in specific detail because they teamed up with two other private groups. And at one point, at the behest, or they thought they were doing it at the behest of Bank of America. Bank of America actually turned down their proposal when it became public, and others. They were going to go after Glenn Greenwald. They were going to go after WikiLeaks and embarrass them and everything else with false leaks and everything, too, because they didn't like what they were doing. These are two private companies. Well, Palantir was not just a private company. Palantir didn't have a client for the first 3 years except the CIA. And it was funded in part by something called InQtel. Now, I brought up my early Ramparts experience only because that story is so much more significant than anything we revealed back then. Anything. The idea that the CIA, which is not supposed to be meddling in our domestic life, forms a company called InQtel, and this goes back before 9/11 to the Total Awareness Program of Poindexter and all that. I don't want to bore you with all the details, but they're fascinating. And anyway, they then use CIA government money to fund hundreds of organizations in Silicon Valley to get the brains and to help them effectively spy on us all. Without restraint, without supervision, without our being able to ask questions. And it's the same as the company that Edward Snowden worked for, Booz Allen, owned by, in part by Carlyle, the investment group. So we have this odd marriage of the business and the private. You had DARPA, which after all was the group that helped develop the internet as a fail-safe means of communication in the event of nuclear war. That whole unit is taken over and goes over to Google to work, almost as a whole unit. And so the mixture of the two has been appalling and been secret, okay? And there are enormous contradictions in it. Now, I'm going to end up tonight, and my wife is here only to sound the bell, because last night at Powell's bookstore, I managed to go on so long that I sold one book. It is a classic example of my folly in this whole business. But at any rate, I don't want to be mercenary and ask two people to buy books tonight, but she pointed out this is not the way you do this thing. And it ended up I had one person, and he was so persistent in his questioning, everyone else left. But anyway, I'll try not to do that tonight and keep it tighter. But anyway, this marriage of the private and public is actually what my book is really all about and what makes it different than other books. You know, why is this day different than all other days? So, and that is what the part that has fascinated me. Because first of all, if the government had ever come to us, for instance, just my Apple VI, if the government had ever asked me to give my thumbprint to the CIA, the FBI, or anyone else as frequently as I did it today, I think I gave Apple or somebody my thumbprint 50 times. Okay? 50 times I told them, yes, I'm the guy buying that record. I'm the guy buying that book. I'm the guy having lunch over there. I'm the guy who wrote this email. I'm the guy, yes, that's me. That's me. You got me nailed. And they tell me with the new watch, they'll have it calibrated to my heartbeat and everything else in case it's stolen, so it'll be even more secure. They'll know it's not some crook who got my watch. It's me, you know. And they'll monitor every moment of my life. So we know the bottom line of this story is the bottom line of private companies. What happened was the internet took off, not because of its original military purpose. The fact is the Cold War ended. The internet took off because it was discovered to be an incredible tool for selling stuff, okay? And why was it an incredible, this is a sad story for my wife to hear because she was the associate editor of the LA Times and a vice president. And as we watched this institution descend into nothingness, along with every other print publication, along with broadcast television, everything, there's one simple answer. And the simple answer is none of those operations, profitable as they were when they had monopolies and in their day, can do what the internet can do in terms of selling, okay? And you know why. Those papers would estimate the preferences of their audience. They would estimate what their audience was, the Nielsen's or any other rating system. And they would figure out whether they are indeed somewhere between 19 and 31. And what do they buy? And then the LA Times salespeople would tell the people on order row, you should have, not should, you must advertise on the weekend because that's how people will come into your Ford dealership and so forth. And then on Monday, the guys say, you know, we didn't do that well. Oh, yeah, but you probably, you would have done worse if you hadn't advertised, right? That was the whole pitch. The internet is something altogether different. It's, as you know, a sea change. On the internet, we can tell not only your age and everything else about you, everything, but we actually can tell what you did with the advertisement that popped up mysteriously. And we can target it, not we, because I don't do that on our website, but the salespeople. And they can find out not only were you curious, but did you buy something? Did it lead to a sale? So it's the killer app, okay? There's never been anything like it. It's wiped out the competition, and it accounts for most of the revenue that has fueled the drive of the internet. You are not the customers. I'm sure you've heard this before. You're not paying for Gmail. You mostly are not operating behind paywalls, you know, and your search engines. It's all being given to you free precisely because you're not the customer. You're the mark. That's just the reality. You're the mark. And the mark's data is what's being marketed. And you're being targeted, okay? And so that would be all right if, in fact, you were a probably armed, knowledgeable consumer. We believe in consumer protection and transparency. And so if you knew what was going on and you were informed every time your data was sold and so forth and how it was being marketed, okay, it's a private transaction between you and a profit-making company. And then you don't like it, you presumably can go to some other company and they'll build up and their search engine or their Gmail or anything else will become attractive, right? So as long as you could keep it in the private sector, you could defend this. And you could defend it internationally, right? Because after all, these companies are multinational. I once wrote a book called America After Nixon, The Age of the Multinationals. This was done in the early 1970s, but actually a very good book. What I predicted was the coming of these companies, which is not a bad thing. Multinational corporations have to operate under certain restraints of a multinational market. They have to keep the faith of lots of folks. But if a multinational corporation can't keep that faith, and that's what Edward Snowden revealed, and they are under the thumb of a national police agency, then why should people outside the borders of your country trust them? That's the contradiction, okay? And so what happened was, as long as we could presume the transactions and the thing that you were giving over your information to was basically your private activity. There's something sad about what happened. I mean, we came to define freedom as consumer sovereignty, the freedom to shop. And, right? I mean, that became it. Choice. But choice was largely, do I want the blue one or the yellow one, or rather eat in that restaurant or this? And the pursuit of the perfect pizza, I learned in Portland, because that's their obsession after beer, is the ultimate act of freedom. Right? You're making these choices. Okay, if that's your choice, it sort of mocks the idea of democracy, political democracy, but at least you were in this private sector. You're making choices. The revelation of Edward Snowden was so significant. And it's an interesting thing, I'll say, there's another story in the New York Times or yesterday about secrecy and classification in which it is admitted, and anybody who's been in the news business will admit this, if they've covered national security or anything else, that most of the reporting on foreign affairs and national security, military and everything, is based on leaks of classified information from the government. And there's an interesting story, I don't know if it was yesterday or today, but I read it this morning in the New York Times, tracing that. So the leaking of classified information is not punished when it makes the government look good or supports one group in the government. The leaking of classified information is only punished when it embarrasses the government, and that is the case. An example I'll just throw out because I think it's stunning. When I was working at the LA Times, I covered the Livermore and Los Alamos labs at one time, wrote a whole book called With Enough Shovels about nuclear war and all that. And I was once on a plane, I think it was back then in the PSA days, not the Southwest days, going into San Jose. And I happened to be in an arms control group at Stanford with Sidrell and Wolfgang Panofsky, two great scientists who, and Sidrell was adjacent, he had the highest clearance. And Condoleezza Rice was a young student and teacher then, she was in the group and so forth, and I enjoyed it. We'd go up there every couple of weeks and talk about arms control. So but I also was writing about these issues. So I get off the plane and I run into Edward Teller, who was on the same plane. Looks like an old around crowd. I don't have to tell you who Edward Teller was, right? Because my students have never heard of him. He's right up there with the Korean War and other subjects that have been forgotten, but because they're not on the SATs. But anyway, Edward Teller, who, among other things, was a pretty nice guy to talk to, and I could chat, and he could take an argument, and I liked him. So we get off the plane, and Edward Teller said, "Where are you going?" I said, "I'm going up to the arms control thing with Sidrell." He said, "Oh," he said, "make sure Sid tells you about the great results we just got on the cottage test." So I said, "Oh, really?" And he said, yeah. I said, "You got lacing?" He says, yeah, great results. He said, "Make sure he tells you about it." Well, Teller was telling me the most important secret in the entire world okay? Because you probably don't remember this whole thing, but there was this fantasy. We would harness the power of nuclear explosion, and we would have a Buck Rogers weapon that would send out an infinite number of laser beams that would destroy anything coming in, including enemy missiles and so forth, and you could have a first strike capability, and you could win a nuclear war. And it would change the whole balance of power, and this was what Star Wars was about, missile defense. There was no more important secret, okay? And here we are, somewhere between the Hertz rental car stand, you know, and the baggage claim, and Edward Teller, the father of the H-bomb with the highest security, blah, 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 a bit daft at that moment, is telling me, I shouldn't say that's unfair, I'm of that age, but, you know, he wasn't, maybe he didn't have his full A game at that moment. Anyway, he's telling me this. Well, the very idea that the cottage test was about, you know, nukes was a secret. But the idea that they got lasing was unbelievable. It would have changed the whole balance of power. Okay? Well, I get up there to Sid Gelsting, and I knock on the door. Hey, Sid, I just ran into Edward Teller. He says you're going to tell me all about the great results they got on the cottage test. Sid Gelsting turns white, out. What are you talking about? Are you trying to entrap me? You know, and he's a great guy, but, you know, this, you don't talk about this stuff, you know? And so I offered, and by the way, it turned out Teller was wrong. Because what had happened was the force of the explosion had distorted the instruments doing the measuring, and they didn't get the lasing. Even though Ronald Reagan, I don't think, ever got the bad news, and he went on with the program. But it illustrates a number of things. It illustrates that that's information we all ought to have at some point. You shouldn't be spending hundreds of billion dollars on a program that shows no sign of success, that may upset the whole balance of power, that may be quite dangerous. It should be debated. Information should, but it's the selective leaking. It's like leaking about weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. It's constant. The Gulf of Tonkin second attack that never happened, that was the justification of war and so forth. So at the bottom of the whole debate is the need for an informed public and the selective use of secrecy. So along comes Edward Snowden. Edward Snowden is in a line with another great whistleblower, Daniel Ellsberg. And by the way, one of the great things about my book, worth the price of admission, I would say, is I have quotes, blurbs on the back from Daniel Ellsberg, who recalls that I covered his 1971 trial, and John Dean, who at that time was White House counsel in the Nixon administration. And I really think it's terrific that at this late stage I could write a book that both thought valuable. And Ellsberg makes the point that when he leaked the Pentagon Papers, and I did cover it at the time, and I knew a lot about this stuff, he thought this would start, you know, lots of people doing this. Because what had he done? Ellsberg had been a hawk, been a Marine originally, was really gung-ho, went off to Vietnam as, you know, a top guy, liked shooting out of planes and everything. And then he gets to work on, and he was a student of Kissinger's and associate of him at Harvard and everything, and he's working on these papers, the Pentagon Papers. And what does he discover? That if you read the Pentagon Papers, you'll know that the whole reason given for the Vietnam War, which ended up killing 3.5 million Indochinese people and almost 59,000 Americans, was a hoax. The whole thing was false. And the whole view of the enemy. We have enemies, but just like now with terrorism, it's an undifferentiated view of an enemy that was stupid, ignored our own role in it, ignored policy choices, and in fact was based on an idea of a monolithic international communism that was absurd because there weren't two communist governments in the world that got along. And you had Yugoslavia, you had the Sino-Soviet dispute, and everything. But most of all, the big compelling argument for Americans, which we're told over and over again, if we don't defeat them in Vietnam, they'll be in San Diego. Okay? Now, what happened? We suffered the most ignominious defeat in American history in Vietnam, right? And they didn't come. It's still, you know, Vietnam is still run by a Communist Party. China's still run by a Communist Party. Neither of them are in San Diego, except fighting over space at Walmart and Costco for pants, socks. But anyway, they didn't invade. What happened? No one even bothered to ask that question. You know, a whole generation of people were raised, if we don't beat them there, they're going to, boom, the dominoes will fall. Nobody ever, what happened? What happened was that Vietnam, communist Vietnam, and communist China went to war. They fought over their border, and they're still fighting over these bloody islands. You know? So it's exactly the opposite of what it predicted. So you have an enemy, yes, we always have enemies, but the undifferentiated, simplistic view that drove the arms race. I remember, oh God, I won't go into my old Boeing stories, but I remember when Scoop Jackson was the senator from here. I used to hang out with him. And I mean, you know, they're around that corner, they're around that corner. Who's around that corner? You know, oh, the international communist conspiracy and its timetable for the takeover of the world. Okay, so it turns out, Pentagon Papers, it's not like that at all. And the Pentagon Papers, you read, no, it's a nationalist movement, an independent movement, obviously, came out of the fight against the French, had 1,000 years of Chinese occupation. The last thing they want is to have the Chinese come in, right? Last thing they want is anybody, foreign power, coming in, fiercely nationalist, blah, blah, blah. So Fulbright, Senator Fulbright, head of foreign, who pushed through the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, said, if I had read that, I wouldn't have voted for the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, if I knew that information, even that senator. So we had, in the case of Ellsbury, an example of several things. How to understand the enemy and all its complexity, how to deal with it, how to fight with it, okay? The importance of informing the American public, and the use of secrecy to destroy thought process, critical thinking, and what have you, all right? So all there. So Ellsberg said, I didn't know that I'd have to wait 40 years for an Edward Snowden. Now, this is not to deny there are other whistleblowers, other truth seekers. But when I think of this 29-year-old guy, and let me tell you something. At one point, my wife was there, she can tell you, at a White House dinner, Hillary Clinton said I was her favorite columnist in America, and then she paused and said, no, in the world. Okay, I know she's never told that to another columnist, okay? But she did say it, okay? And I will tell you, after Hillary Clinton's attack on Edward Snowden, and I have voted for lesser evils my whole life. I even voted for Dianne Feinstein every time she ran, and she's been terrible on these issues. I'm a sucker for a lesser evil, you know? But I could never vote for Hillary Clinton after that statement. Because Hillary Clinton was there in the State Department. She knew what was going on. She had the nerve not to trust the State Department with her own email. But I'm supposed to trust they're coming after my email. I mean, it's astounding. Absolutely astounding. Okay, I don't want to tell you who to vote for. It's all right. You make your own. No, I mean, I'm not going to. But I mean, it's just incredible what has happened. And Dianne Feinstein. And then, you know, Barack Obama, this great, you know, professor of constitutional law who knows more about the Fourth Amendment than I do. He understands the need for all this and everything. My wife maxed out in contributions to him. I didn't do as well, but, you know, I thought he was the second coming and everything. And, you know, we're always misled on the basics. It's astounding. So I think then there's this 29-year-old guy, and he does this incredible thing. He does what Ellsberg does. He looks and he says, what the hell is going on? What are they doing? And he decides, because why, well, I don't know, saw some movie once about, you know, Clarence Darrow or something. He says, you know, this is wrong. People have a right to know about it, you know? And people keep asking questions, challenging his motives and everything. The question I would put to everybody is, why didn't everyone tell us? There's supposed to be over 1 million people who had a security clearance on his level. Why didn't they? Where are they? Why don't they tell us? You know, they work for different congressional committees, they work for different agencies, and so forth. So I would turn that around. Why do we have so few whistleblowers? That's number one. But secondly, why did the government's response contain blaming the whistleblowers? And again, I'm picked on Hillary Clinton, but let's take Barack Obama. The fact that this administration has gone after people who have revealed the truth, whistleblowers and others of that sort, more actively than all other presidents combined. Again, I read that in the New York Times yesterday or today, and it's true. It's in my book also. You know, that's astounding. Somebody who at this moment in history had an obligation to say, as a constitutional law professor and the editor of the Harvard Law Review, I'm here to use the bully pulpit to tell you why we can't do this, okay? So let me get to why we can't do this, and then I'll get to the optimistic ending. Am I close to my 40 minutes?
You can keep going.
Okay. She says that easily, but, you know, 2 hours from now, you fucked up again, you know. Okay. Okay.
Robert's in the cell phone. You talked about the unanimous decision, but you didn't tell me what.
Okay. It's a good point. But I was going to get that to the end. Okay. But I'll make a note about it. Okay, but seriously, let me just try to get through this with some dispatch. Okay, so two basic points that I want to make about all this. One is the complicity between the private and the government sector is extensive, it's massive, and because it's the private sector, it's very difficult to challenge, ironically, okay? Because they say it's their business model and so forth, you know? If I wanted to find out what is Palantir doing, I did try to find out recently, at the LAPD, I only know that because of a leaked document, well, that's proprietary information. That's there, and the same thing with the, you know, the program we discussed before with the cell tower and so forth. So it seems to me that there's been an abdication of responsibility of our elected officials. And this thing of delegating to the private sector is astounding, and it's unchecked, and it's a violation of the whole spirit of our Constitution. Secondly, however, because of this and the use of private data, there is, as you're old enough to remember Leonard Cohen, and there's a crack in everything, that's how the light gets through. It's one of my favorite songs. Anyway, this is the crack in it that the light gets through. Because once Edward Snowden came up with these revelations, there were others, but and he's absolutely right, and it's the same thing Daniel Ellsberg has said in defense of Snowden, that you had to turn over a lot of it. Now, he did it the same way that Ellsberg did. Ellsberg did not turn everything over, and he turned it over. First, he tried to turn it over to senators, and then he turned it over to the New York Times, and when they got blocked by a court, he gave it to the Washington Post. Snowden has done that. Snowden did not turn over everything. Snowden turned it over to three respectable news organizations, the Washington Post, and I have something to say about Washington Post in relation to Amazon in a minute, and turned it over to The Guardian. And they made decisions about what you should reveal and not, and what gives up sources. And there's an irony in this, by the way. One thing we generally all agree is, yeah, there needs to be some government secrecy, and certainly in terms of protecting people, okay, who are operatives or working and they're risking their life. That seems to be a no-brainer. You know, the Philip Agee thing, why do you have to release these names? Unless, I would argue, they've committed torture and crimes, and they should be subject to the same laws that everyone else is, you know. I mean, so, but generally, why are you giving up sources and so forth? Everything. Then you have two interesting cases on this, by the way, that doesn't come up. One was the movie Zero Dark Thirty, right? And the director and the writer of Zero Dark Thirty are invited to an ultra-secret meeting of the CIA to thank and to honor the Navy SEALs who went after Bin Laden, and they have their names on. And they are introduced to them, and they meet them, and shake hands, and so forth. This is a big secret. Who are these guys? They're supposed to be protected. They're targets of assassination. And why was the CIA doing this? Because they wanted a movie that would justify torture. So again, the selective leaking. That's a well-documented case. Another is a case of a colleague of mine at USC, General Petraeus, CIA director. Who I don't forget the name of his chair or what he does, but I saw him in the faculty dining room the other, you know, a couple months ago. And look at the Petraeus case. He has the most intimate notes from the center of power, handwritten in these volumes of his meetings with the President of the United States, discussions, CIA director with the President, names of agents, everything. And I don't want to demonize his mistress or anything. I know she did honorable service for the government and was in the service and everything. But what was he thinking? And we know what he was thinking. I'm on the side of the angels. I'm in power. Power doesn't corrupt me. Whatever I do is always right, right? I'm not going to betray the American people. I am the American people. I am the ultimate hero. I'm not going to be subject to that standard. And of course, he isn't. He gets a plea bargain, no time. Okay? So ultimate hypocrisy on all this. So now let me get back to, and I'll end with this question that my wife wants me to bring up, the decision on the cell phone case. The big argument that comes in this is that was then and this is now. Okay? And the big argument is before 9/11, after 9/11. All right? And so, for instance, I was writing about privacy before 9/11. There was some debate and everything. After 9/11, no. We've been attacked. This is the most dangerous and hypocritical attack on the notion of freedom. It, first of all, is presupposing that freedom is a luxury to be afforded only in the most stable, secure societies that have no problems. It is inherently a mockery of the notion of freedom. The notion of freedom that the founders gave us was that freedom is a necessity to sound governance. Freedom is the corrective. To be secure in your person and possessions and home and your colleagues is to be secure in having a free press, the right to assemble, the right to redress grievance, and so on. Okay? Freedom is not an indulgence for the best of times. It is a necessity in the worst of times. Think about it. These folks gave us the Fourth Amendment, which they tell us, you know, get over it, we can't have it anymore, when they thought the England, the King of England, would come back. And he did, remember, 1812. You know, there were other big enemies. We had a fragile experiment in government here. These guys could have been hanging from the nearest tree and everyone in their family. They gave us these protections, not when they were the biggest superpower the world has ever known, the United States, spending as much as the entire world combined on our military, able to kill people without accountability anywhere in the world, anytime we want, drones and otherwise. These were this rabble here in the colonies enshrined this protection of freedom. Why? Because truth drives out error. You don't want to go down the false road. You don't want to follow false leaders. You need your citizens to be independent, strong, and knowledgeable. After 9/11, we turned that on its head. You know, we said, no, we can't afford that anymore. We've been attacked. Now, first of all, you talked about just about any place in the world. And just pick on the map, and you could see where their attacks were much more vicious. You know, existential is the word people like to use, you know. Come on. You want to tell me anywhere? Anyway, the Ukraine, you know, where? Go. You want Turkey and Greece? Where do you want to go? Any place. Israel. Palestinians, you know. Anywhere. And you say to people there, no, you should respect rule of law. You should respect human rights. That's right, we stand for. You should respect limited government. You should have a free press, right? Every one of those countries can tell you, are you kidding? Do you know what terrible things we've experienced? And our argument, and I've had this argument, damn it, I had this argument with Fidel Castro in a safe house in Havana, where I told him the UMAP camps in which he was rounding up homosexuals was immoral and destroying his society. And that was a hell of a long time ago. It was the night the Soviets invaded Czechoslovakia, okay? You can Google it and look at the time. And he had guys with submachine guns around. I'm no hero, okay? But I was doing an interview, you know, and talking to him. And for some reason, that was on my mind because it was happening and I had witnessed it. And I said, you're making your society weaker. You're destroying your society. You're destroying it as any kind of model, all right? That's an argument that has been raised everywhere in the world where people fight for freedom. Everywhere. And the argument that always comes back, no, we have enemies, we have enemies, we have enemies. Therefore, we can't be free. It's a denial of the assumption of the American Constitution. Freedom makes you stronger. The reason my wife wants me to bring up the Roberts decision, which is so powerful, is it answers two questions. It deals with the question of whether technology trumps these principles, and it deals with the need for accountability, okay? And what the Roberts Court said in that decision, the reason it applies to the cell phone case, this was involved the police grabbing a smartphone, right? And it was decision was June 14th. It was unanimous, so it's the liberals and conservatives. And in that decision, and the argument of the police, the government, and so forth, was the Fourth Amendment doesn't apply, Fourth Amendment's to your house, and so forth. Well, that had already been stretched. About wiretapping, and do you come up to what? But the Roberts Court answered that question definitively. It said that the Fourth Amendment not only implies, but it has to be applied in a much broader vision because of the new technology. And what Roberts did, and he began with the Otis and Adams in that original case of why we had a Fourth Amendment, and he said, and I know for some people it's difficult to think of Roberts as a great jurist, but it's a very, very important decision. And in that decision, he said that on a smartphone, you have more information about a human being than ever was ever in anybody's house. The most personal, the most detailed information. They know everything about you, okay, on that smartphone. And he said, if the police, in the course of an arrest, can grab that phone and then crack your password or whatever and get all that information, that's exactly the general warrant that the King of England wanted and that our Constitution is designed to prevent. And that because of the technological power of these devices and the internet and so forth, precisely because of that, we have to have an expanded view of the Fourth Amendment rather than destroy it. He took on the main argument of, you know, people like when Eric Schmidt said, don't do anything, you know, that you want to hide, you know, privacy's over, Zuckerberg, get used to it. As I pointed out, when it's their house that's being designed, they like a lot of privacy and they'll buy all the houses around. But the reason that was a stupid statement for Eric Schmidt or Zuckerberg to make was it denies really what free activity and free thought is all about. Free thought is all about having wrong ideas. It's about thinking and outside of the box. It's about questioning. It's about not being so careful in your living room conversations and when you and Tom Paine write that pamphlet, right? And you certainly don't want prior censorship when you and Tom Paine write that pamphlet, okay? And you want to be able to work things out and think things out before you go assemble to redress grievances. And you don't want to be observed at every moment, because when you're observed at every moment, we have the famous experiment, they don't even have to be up there looking at you, you engage in self-censorship. And my view is, when I talk, you know, to younger people, it's interesting how it breaks down in my class. I have about 400 or 500 students a year, and I love it because I'm not intimidated by what are young people thinking, or I got them coming out of my ears. And I like them, and they're smart. They're smarter than any other group that's ever been. And the internet can be a great device. When I bring John Dean into my class, they've never heard of him, and they hardly know anything about Watergate. By that weekend, they know more than their parents, because they have the internet. They can read original documents. They can get up to speed and so forth if you get curiosity. But what I've noticed in my class, and I've noticed going around speaking to younger audiences, ones who come from other countries where they do not have a benign view of their government, you know, whether it was Iran or whether it was mainland China or China, you know, whether it's Russia, whatever, you know, Latin America, they get it right away. They don't want the police to have this power. It's only because people in this country have accepted a benign view of government, you know, a benign view of government. And it's very threatening to the idea of what the country's all about. And so what is really at issue here is self-censorship. It's assuming either that shopping is the main activity of freedom or that the government will always be your ally, okay? Now, finally, what is the cost of this? The cost is that you make wrong decisions. The fact is, after 9/11, we had an intimidated population in a way that I have not seen it since World War II. I'm an old guy. I've been around. I never saw anything like that. You know, somehow, after 9/11, people couldn't think straight. You know, no, we have to suppress freedom. And by the way, can you just imagine if that had been a small nuclear explosion, right, of the kind the Japanese experienced at Hiroshima or Nagasaki? Well, forget, freedom would be over, be gone. You know, I mean, we'd be rounded up. You know, I worked on a movie called The Siege. Anybody see it? Denzel Washington? It came out just before 9/11, and I have a debate with Arianna Huffington in that movie, because we did a show together for a long time, and they were rounding up everyone in Brooklyn, because there had been a particularly severe terrorist attack. And the question was that unrealistic? Would they round up everyone in Brooklyn? And say, well, let me tell you, if it had been, there had been more injuries, yes. So I want to make a final point about that. People who advance the argument about security and safety do not examine the evidence. And it's something I do in a painstaking way in my book. Okay? Now, even if you could make the case that we would be marginally safer or even this, I would still argue end justifies the means, what are you sacrificing, and so forth. But what is appalling about this whole discussion is there is not a single example that our government has come up with where getting this haystack of information has found this bad needle. Not one. When the President of the United States, and in my book I systematically go through all the examples, when the President of the United States defended this and attacked Snowden, he said, we have to do this because of their, and he offered one example, Mindar, the 19th hijacker in San Diego. Well, Mindar, anyone who followed this, read the 9/11 Commission, read anything about this, knows Mindar was staying at the house of an FBI informant. He and his buddy were being observed by the FBI constantly and the CIA. And the only criticism you can make is the CIA and the FBI didn't compare notes. And Mindar had made a call to a so-called safe house in Yemen. And the President of the United States had the effrontery to say, we couldn't get that information. No, you could. You know, pick up your cell phone and call AT&T. Says the President of the United States that I need this number. What are you talking about? AT&T has rolled over for you every single time. You know, but why don't you have that number? Why didn't you have the right? Why couldn't you go to the FISA call? Why couldn't you have done any of these things? You know, you could tap that phone going into Yemen and here, you knew where they were. And in every single case, let's just take the two most prominent ones, the Boston Marathon bombing, okay, and the Charlie Hebdo cartoonist massacre. And I really hate the idea that those guys are used now as an argument for attacking freedom. I knew them when I was editor of Ramparts. I had contact. We were kindred spirits and so forth. It's appalling. But in both cases, the perps, okay, were well known to the police. In the Boston Marathon and Charlie Hebdo. One of them in the Charlie Hebdo case has served time. All you needed, if you were curious about what they were up to, was what you did in the old days, right? You got a half-sober cop to drive over there, sit outside, talk to a few neighbors, and find out what they're up to. It didn't require collecting the data on everybody in the whole world, including the leader of Germany and Brazil. You know, okay? You know, there's an incredible inefficiency built into it. But, and let me, I do want to conclude on this to have questions and then leave time for our further discussion. I don't want to make a serious point in that relation to the cost. When I was editor of Ramparts, I published Martin Luther King. I loved the movie Selma, by the way. I thought more credit should have been given to John Lewis and Snick and so forth. I found the argument that Lyndon Johnson was slighted detestable. If Lyndon Johnson had any conscience at all, he knew what Hoover was up to in destroying King and following him and trying to get him to commit suicide. And LBJ could have pulled Hoover, kicked him out of government. That's what you're supposed to do. You know, it's like when MacArthur was fired by Harry Truman. You can do it. And MacArthur was a lot more popular than J. Edgar Hoover, although he didn't have all his files. But the fact of the matter is, you know, there was Martin Luther King, and I know why they were after King, because King was not staying put. King was a moral force, you know? And King said that I have to deal with poverty, and I have to deal with war. And after Selma, I remember, because I published in Ramparts, King's speech at Riverside Church condemning the United States as the major purveyor of violence in the world today, Martin Luther King. And he said, how can I condemn violence in the ghetto by young kids and then you draft them and you send them off to fight in Vietnam and to kill and be killed? And so King had become an irritant to people of power, okay? A big irritant. And when he died, he was there working with garbage collectors who are on strike and so forth, dealing with the poverty issue. So he wouldn't stay put in his moral concerns. Now, I want to end on an ominous note, and then I'll end on a positive. I've got two things. The ominous note is where if there's a king alive today, he'll be destroyed and you won't even know it. And I'm not talking about the creepy stuff like you control his cars and smash into a cliff or do all the other things that can be done with modern technology. I mean, all of us are vulnerable to people who want to smear us, whether they use true stuff or false stuff, whether they make it, whether they manufacture it. You know, Scott Ritter, who was the most effective critic of the whole phony weapons of mass destruction, you know, they entrap, he gets entrapped by a police agent in some kind of internet sex thing or something, you know, and serves time in jail. Elliot Spitzer, the most effective critic of the banks when he was Attorney General in New York and then governor, he get, you know, suddenly it's a big deal that he went to a house of prostitution or something and he's destroyed. So the ability to destroy people, like a Martin Luther King or anyone else, is out there. It's in the hands of all these government agencies, all these police forces, and trust me, it's going to be rampant. But I don't like to end on a pessimistic note, so I'm going to end on a positive one that I think is true. And I meant to mention the multinational corporations. Okay. And that includes Amazon. You know, and Amazon has, in my book, I attack Amazon because I might raise some questions. How can you both be in the business of building the cloud for all the intelligence agencies, and you're also, as an individual, not as a company, but Jeff Bezos takes over the Washington Post? You know, what has happened? Is the Washington Post still going to be a critical news outlet about government when, in fact, your other business is in bed with the government developing the cloud that's going to contain all this information, huge contract and so forth? So there are a lot of questions to raise about the private sector. They're real. They're serious. Why was Microsoft so quiet about everything? Why didn't they join the others vigorously? Why, for instance, on the battle over encryption? Here you have this absurd situation where the head of the FBI and CIA are saying that Apple and Google can't do encryption to protect their customer or their users, right? Man, think of that. Head of the FBI attacks these companies for trying to do something right by their people, and you wonder why everyone isn't up in arms about it. But the light that comes through that I think exists is that this will destroy America's main export right now. And this includes playing around with the hardware, planting stuff on the hardware and everything. Because what has been said to the world is you can't trust an American-based multinational. And it's not just wackos somewhere, you know. It's very clear, say, to the European Union. They don't want the little Google trucks going around filming everybody's house. They're suspicious of their motives. Who are you working for? Are you working for the NSA? You're working for someone else. And this is true all over the world. Big battle. Yes, I would like to see Google and Facebook get into China. I think it would be good for the Chinese people. But the counter argument will be trust the thieves you know rather than the thieves outside. You know, go with our local companies. And so what the United States government has done, once it got revealed, if it wasn't revealed, these companies didn't show a conscience. A few did. You know, T-Mobile did, a few smaller ones showed some pushback. But in the main, once the cat was out the bag, you can't be a multinational corporation and be effective selling hardware, selling software, or anything else, if you can't have the trust of people you're dealing with. The word multinational means you're transcending nation state. The nation state is a thing of the past, okay? It's an anachronism. And we have been dragged back into a new Cold War based on this unit of the nation state. And the other thing is our government has sent a message to the world that everyone should do it. And the lesson of the alleged North Korean hacking of Sony, which no one seems to have taken up, is that if a two-bit dictatorship like North Korea can hack the most sophisticated, or one of the most sophisticated electronics companies in the world, and get their most internal email, any government can do it. Eric Schmidt in his book said you can take stuff off the shelf and any government in the world can do it. So we have set a model for the world. Instead of asserting to the world, no, everyone is entitled to a zone of privacy. Everyone is entitled to have their basic rights protected. Everyone is entitled to controls on government, limited government, all the things that we have been saying in terms of our Constitution and our model, we have denied. We have given a black mark to. And that is a very, very big price to make, and it will not make us more secure in the long run. So thank you. Okay, was that cheerful enough?
Yeah.
Okay. Do we have questions, or should we go right to the local folks? Or what? Oh, yes.
I have a question about network neutrality. I haven't really kept track of this very well, but I FCC has made a decision. It's somewhat broad in general, and they're gonna try to treat the internet as a utility. But you know, there's going to be many steps before it ever really anything really changes. Apparently. Do you think it's headed in the right direction? Do you think it will continue to, well, improve?
Well, one reason I do want to hear from local people who care about privacy is I don't think these things are ever settled on the highest level. if there isn't grassroots support, if public isn't aware, and so forth, we don't get real progress. It is very good that the Obama administration has shifted its position, that the FTC has shifted its position. I believe very much in the idea of net neutrality in its simplest sense of there's a highway and we all want to be. I don't like toll roads in Orange County, California. I don't like, you know, I think we can all design our own cars and we can all figure out where we want to go with these cars, but there ought to be a highway that is a public resource that is maintained and we all have an equal opportunity to use it. And as somebody who has a struggling internet site, I'm not going to sing tears. We get millions of people when we have something good. I love it. If we had to pay for the extra fast lanes, we'd be out of business. And because most of us on the internet don't make money. Most of us are chasing some dream, you know, because the big money is made by the data miners. We all know that. I mean, Google gets 95 or 97%, depending on how you calculate it, from invading your privacy. And that's generally true. And then there are these apps that take off, and they do that. Most people using the internet are not making money at it. They're losing money. And yet it's a great thing for just that reason. It is a free market. It is a place where people can put out their wares, you know, and if it takes off and goes viral, then you reach a big audience, whether it's for a social cause, for another good product, or something. So that's what's liberating about the internet, is people being able to show their wares and get a shot at a bigger audience and then maybe even paying their costs or making money. And fortunately, the FTC now has come to a sensible position. Again, one reason is there are some big players who are on the right side of this, right? I mean, Google has come out in support of it, others, you know. And so, you know, we're not alone in this. But I would never underestimate the power of greedy lobbyists. I mean, they're working night and day at everything and to distort everything. You know, I'm not telling you something you don't know. So this is certainly not a battle that's been won. But I'll tell you the biggest danger to the internet is the balkanization. And that comes from the secrecy stuff. If people around the world, and you know, and this gives license to governments that don't want a free internet. You know, China's a good example. And they could say, wait a minute. You know, we're not just blocking Google because we're threatened by freedom. We're blocking Google because we don't want the NSA getting all this. Okay? That's the balkanization that will destroy the web. Once you put up all these walls and you let nationalism run supreme, you don't get your Arab Spring. You get a distortion. And so, to answer your question, I think net neutrality and everything that comes with it is a very important battle worth having. I mean, needed. Yeah.
Would you care to comment further on Hillary's emails?
Yeah. I find it, what's the right word? It's just shocking, okay? I mean, it's just shocking. Here, first of all, we wouldn't know, I mentioned it in connection with Snowden. You know, we wouldn't know much of what we know, or at least have it confirmed. Hence, and sharp people, I'm sure, in Seattle, you know, and elsewhere knew it. But, you know, what Snowden did is he said, hey, this is going on, and this is not right, and you can't deny it. You know, there is this prison program, here's the chart, and there is this, and there is that, and that. Hillary Clinton had the nerve to say he should have used channels. There would have been a debate without him. She knows there was no debate without him. She knows there were no channels. He was working for a private contractor. There's no whistleblower protection. She knows that if they grabbed this, she, you know, her department, her ex-department, grabbed his passport. He wasn't intending to go to Russia. He was in transit, you know. So for Hillary Clinton to take that hard line, and it's not the first time. You know, Hillary Clinton is the one who originally said she, when she was working for the banks, the Madison Bank down there in Little Rock, you know, you can't be a successful lawyer without working for banks. I remember that one. You know, I can go through a lot of Hillary. Hillary Clinton didn't object to Bill Clinton's welfare reform, which ended the federal poverty program, aid to families with dependent children. You know, Hillary Clinton went along with the Iraq War based on lies. You know, Hillary Clinton carried water for, you know, this is turning into an anti-Hillary attack, but you asked for more. But Hillary Clinton carried water from the banks in the biggest, you know, social crisis that we've had since the Great Depression, and hurt people enormously. And so this email thing just shows the prerogatives of power, that they can live in another world, okay? You know, if I had an affair with an intern, I would not be teaching at the USC, okay? I certainly wouldn't get reelected president of the United States and have my wife run, you know, to take my place and keep it as a family dynasty, all right? There is a double standard. Let's face it, these people are of power. They enjoy power. They are protected by power. They are the prerogatives of power. They are the very people our Constitution warns us against, whether they are on the left or the right, whether they are, you know, call themselves progressive or reactionary. They represent the corruptions of power. They forget where they came from. They forget who they are responsible to. Let's face it, you realize with the banking meltdown, I don't want to get onto my last book, but the main victims of that were black and brown people. Hispanics lost 2/3 of their wealth, not their yearly income, of everything they own. African Americans lost more than 50% of their wealth, their accumulated family wealth. Pew Research Center statistics. I mean, the devastation was incredible. The income inequality in America has mushroomed ever since Clinton was president. I'm not blaming him solely for it. But the fact that these people get a free ride, and I'm speaking with some venom because I was a Clinton supporter. I drank the Kool-Aid, okay? I still cannot watch Bill Clinton on television without smiling. You know, and Barack Obama for that matter, you know? Preached, you know, I know the trap. I know it well, you know, but I'm going to say something on the privacy issue. We, those of us who care about privacy, have important allies on the other side. In my research for this book, I would say the most important, informed people that I interviewed, would, most of them call themselves libertarians. That doesn't mean all libertarians are enlightened and care. Some, you know, go with the Koch brothers and everything else. But when I went to Electronic Frontier Foundation, go to any of these groups that are out there fighting year after year to protect our privacy, they turn out to be Republicans as often as Democrats. They turn out to be libertarians as often as bleeding heart liberals. You know, it's one of the great strengths of this country. We have a mythology deep down of individual freedom. It's not just the Second Amendment. You know, that'd be a good bumper sticker. If you like the Second Amendment so much, you'll love the Fourth Amendment, you know? but anyway, it's a long-winded answer. I feel badly about it, you know? I should have my wife speak, because she had she confronted Bill Clinton when she was at the American Society of Newspaper Editors about why he didn't do anything about the women and girls in Afghanistan, and got a really nothing terrible answer. And we then had a meeting after, and Chelsea corrected her father, you know, in front of him, saying, yeah, Dad, you dropped the ball on that. You know, so I'm not saying these people started out being bad. I'm not saying they had to be bad. I think it'd be a great victory to have a woman president. I just don't want Margaret Thatcher as my president. That was too close. That was below the belt. I'm sorry. She's better than Margaret Thatcher. Okay. Yes?
About to put smart meters here in Seattle, and a number of us are very concerned about the privacy issues, but also the health issues and the fire issues and the cost issues. Can you speak to that?
Not really. I mean, I'm not an expert on it. Maybe other folks want to talk about it. My approach to basically the whole gadgetry, the technology, and so forth is it's all alarming. Well, like picking up the paper today and, you know, being reminded of what's done with cell towers, the thermostat in your home. You know, we just had thermostats put in the building we lived in. We live in L.A. It's a big complex, and what's in that thermostat, you know? What's in that meter? And anything, you know, this is one of those things they used to say, paranoids have enemies, all right? Well, we're moving to a situation where paranoids are going to be right all the time. I mean, it's like, it's crazy. And so the technology develops very rapidly. It's unquestioned, and you know, we catch, and you know, we don't have watchdogs. And that's why, for the life of me, well, you can disagree with everything I said tonight. Don't disagree with me and claim the defensive logic and fact and disagree with me on Edward Snowden. I mean, because, I mean, and we can disagree a lot of things, but the idea that somehow our democracy was not enhanced, I would argue saved maybe, by Edward Snowden. I don't get it. Where do you think you will get the information? So on anything anybody brings up here, there's somebody, you know, there was somebody at AT&T, remember, in San Francisco, who told us about that mysterious room where they were gathering data, right? Yeah. You know, so I don't want to say Snowden's the only one, okay? But it's pathetic how few we've had. It's pathetic how few people do not put careerism above everything else. You know, it's amazing. We are a society that prides itself on its rugged individualism, its thirst for freedom, right? You know, so the question to ask, you know, not why Edward Snowden, why not 10,000 Edward Snowdens? Think about it, you know, and on any one of these stories, but on the specifics, maybe in the discussion we have later, you folks can address it, I don't know. Any other questions or hello? Yeah. You know, we've been married come on up here, daughter. We've been married for 38 years, and we have the same squabbles that we had the first week.
You don't go away because
I'm not going away. Oh, she wants to read.
No, I'm not gonna read this.
Read the darkness.
I'm not gonna read it, but because I don't need to read it, I'm gonna just tell it. So there's a woman named Regina Dugan who works for Google. She went to work in 2012 for Google, but before that she worked for the defense agency that was the kind of innovation development agency that gave us drones and the GPS and the internet. It was that defense department agency that she worked for. And she went to work for Google and brought a lot of the people who were with her in the defense department. But she gave a speech, this is in Bob's book, and I haven't seen this anywhere else. She gave a speech to an industry group, and she was talking about, and I thought about this when he talked about the Apple Watch and how it's gonna, you know, it detects your heartbeat and your pulse, so it'll always know who has that watch. So she was talking about, Google has developed a vitamin pill. She called it a vitamin pill.
Read the paragraph.
Okay, yeah, her words are really great. she said, hold on. She showed that a tattoo on her forearm that is an identifier. And she said that, you know, maybe teenagers and young people won't want to wear watches, and I think she was thinking of the Apple Watch. So she held out her arm, and there was a large microchip embedded in the skin above her bracelets. And she said, quote, "Now, it may be true that 10 to 20-year-olds may not want to wear a watch on their wrist, but you can be sure that they'd be far more interested in wearing an electronic tattoo, if only to piss off their parents." And then the group laughed. That's something you wear, but you can also imagine including authentication in just your daily habits. So I take this vitamin every morning. What if I just take a vitamin authentication? I have one right here, and she pulls out a white tablet in front of this audience. This pill has a small chip inside of it with a switch. It also has what amounts to an inside-out potato battery. When you swallow it, the acids in your stomach serve as the electrolyte, and they power it up, and the switch goes on and off. And essentially, it creates an 18-bit EKG-like signal in your body, and essentially your entire body becomes an authentication token. This becomes my first superpower. It means that my arms are like wires, my hands are like alligator clips, and when I touch my phone, my computer, my door, my car, I'm authenticated in. First superpower, like I want that. We're not shipping it right away, she tells them. But here's the thing, this is not science fiction. This pill has been CE stamped, which is the European Economic Area, to be sold in Europe. It's already been stamped for approval there. And it's been cleared by the FDA. And then she said, we at Google can tell you've taken your pill.
No.
I just think that's just, you know, because the point, one of Bob's points is that people, it's like they go along, they say, I'm not doing anything wrong. Why do I care what they know about me? But, you know, this can just go on to a ridiculous extreme.
And thank you, Nora. Okay. Did I leave anything? Okay. So are we, is any last question? Are we done?
Oh, yeah. I have one more question.
Okay.
I wanted you to comment on the Trans-Pacific Partnership, otherwise known as the TPP, which is currently being slotted to fast track through Congress. And how you feel like that would threaten individual privacy and also the nation state sovereignty that you brought up earlier in the talk.
Yeah, I think we have I know we have a very good article on that very subject on Truthdig, and we have a good writer who has been covering it. I think, again, I'm not going to wing anything that I'm not an expert on, but I think the big problem in all of the international agreements, all of the understandings, all of the passage rights and everything else is, my slogan in journalism is who's getting screwed and who's doing the screwing. And where's the accountability? What does it lead to? Who does it enfranchise? And in every one of these discussions, and this includes the internet, includes safeguard, includes copyright, trademark, includes NAFTA, go right down the list, there's almost no presence of what I would call ordinary people. It's done by an international lobbying effort of so-called experts who are basically on the take, who go through the revolving door, who are rewarded at every turn, so their so-called government service is intended to reap rewards in the private sector. And I'll give you one example of somebody I actually do admire. But to make this point, because I know he's on a speaking tour just like I am, Barney Frank has a new book. Is he speaking here?
Yeah.
Okay. He'll speak somewhere. And I'll just give you one last little story about this. Trying to cover, this is really what we're talking about, because basically I'm a reporter, right? And my job is to go figure out what's going on. And generally, when you go figure out what's going on, and this is an argument I have at our school, where public relations now is a bigger department than journalism, okay? Where, you know, basically we train people to go out into that world and con other people and sell things and blah, blah, blah. With, you know, there are exceptions. Some people do Teach for America or something so they can hold down teachers' salaries. But anyway, leaving that aside. And so when I was doing this very thing about Financial Services Modernization Act, and I was trying to cover it. And, you know, I'm not living that my whole life. I'm not the staffer. This is not my area of expertise for 50 years. But I do bring fresh eyes. You know, I do come in. And I did study economics in graduate school there. But I do come in with fresh eyes. What's going on? Okay. So I went to Barney Frank pretty early on, and I knew him. And I popped into his office. I had an appointment around 5 o'clock one afternoon. It's kind of getting dark outside. And I really respected this guy enormously. And I said, you know, and he was head of the banking committee. I said, do you realize what's in this bill? Or maybe you can explain it to me. It looks terrible. This is the reversal of the most sensible rules of the road developed by Franklin D. Roosevelt. Why are good folks like you looking the other way? And it wasn't just him. It was Jesse Jackson. It was, you know, all kinds of people supported it. You know, and I said, why is this? And Barney, I'll never forget this. He said, you know, Bob, this stuff is really complicated. And I have a reception that I have to go anyway. It's getting late. But Charles on my staff, he says, he really follows this for me, and he's great. Go see Charles. So next day I go see Charles. And I say, Charles, Congressman Frank said that you could explain this to me. And blah, blah, blah. So when I've got this whole thing marked up, and I'm talking to these people and everything. And I play Columbo as a reporter. Remember Columbo? You know, I'm a little bit slow. One other question, you know, I don't know, it wasn't mentioned, but I'm the one that Jimmy Carter talked to about lust in his heart. That was one last question, you know. So I'll do that. So this guy's explaining to us, and he says, again, he's got a meeting now, a committee meeting. And he said, look, you know, I do this, but it's one of the many things that I do. This was very important legislation. He said, Lewis, so forth, go see him. He really knows this. I mean, this is, I'm not telling you this is not unusual. This is how you get, you know, led around. And, you know, usually the elected officials haven't read anything. Very few of them read the Patriot Act, you know, and knew what was in there. And in fact, the guy who was credited with writing the Patriot Act has now got the bill to repeal it. He said it's terrible, and he's a Republican. So I said to him, wait a minute, you want me to talk to this guy? I said, this guy is a lobbyist for the banks. He says, yeah, but he's a good guy. You know? And then you realize these lobbyists now, they're not just old, fat, white guys bellying up to the bar. You want a transvestite lobbyist, you want a Latino lobbyist, you want an old white guy lobbyist, they'll supply one. They come in all sizes, all shapes, all politics. They all talk a good game. They are absolutely brilliant. They know all the talking points. They write the speeches. And this is how government works. This is what government is, certainly on the national level. Maybe in a local city council, you'll get a couple of brave spirits who stand up and can do some grassroots organizing. But if you really want to know how government works on any of these issues, you know, by the time you get through these conversations, things you thought were absolutely horrible turn out to have a really bright side to them. Okay? And it's not just in the world of government, it's the world of journalism. You know, people that I have debated with, done things with and everything, you finally look at, you know, when they have to make disclosures, you find out, oh, they get a lot of money for a speaking engagement. Hillary Clinton is not alone. We haven't even mentioned that. What does it mean for somebody who wants to be president of the United States to go give two speeches to Goldman Sachs for $500,000? What the hell is she telling us with that act? What does it really mean? And it's worse if she tells us, oh, it doesn't influence my vote at all. You know, that means you've taken so much money you can afford to give away a little. You know, what does it mean? Larry Summers, when Barack Obama picked him, had made that year $8 million. You know, $4 million from D. Shore Hedge Fund. And this guy was the head of Harvard. You know, so if you look at the degree of corruption, and trust me, in the national security establishment, if you look at the revolving door that Narda was talking about, DARPA and all this, people coming in and out, it's astounding, the fortunes that are made, you know? And so, again, what we have, this is, I think, a takeaway line that we should really think about. The whole reason, again, George Washington, the impostures of pretended patriotism, okay? The whole thing is, if the people analyzing the threat, right? This is what Eisenhower warned about in military-industrial complex. The people analyzing the threat are also going to profit from making the hardware or the software to meet the threat, right? And then they're going to go through that revolving door. You have a self-fulfilling prophecy here. You have an industry out of control. And that's what you have with terrorism. Terrorism will never end. Terrorism will always be with us. You'll always have exceptional, brutal acts. Okay? It's just part of life. That people can do bad things and they can find the means of inflicting harm. And, you know, even if you turn yourself into a police state, you're still not going to stop it. Okay? The Soviets tried that in Chechnya. Russians tried it in Chechnya. It doesn't work. Okay? But if you're allowed to inflate these dangers, if you're allowed to exaggerate, if you're allowed to design, you know, thing, then you're out of control. And so think about it for a second. Right now, we're traumatized by ISIS, right? That's the new Al-Qaeda, because Al-Qaeda was going out of steam. We got ISIS, okay? Where did ISIS, a kid in elementary school could ask a question. Where did they come from? How come we didn't know about them 3 years ago? Are they part of the same freedom fighting group we were supporting against Assad in Syria that Hillary supported? you know, John McCain supported. And then we say, okay, they're terrible, they're evil, and it's because of their interpretation of Islam, right? Which is very much influenced by the Saudi model and so forth. At the same moment, they say, oh, many of them say, this is one good thing, I haven't been positive about the Obama administration. Finally, they're doing a good thing, trying to negotiate a non-proliferation agreement with Iran, long overdue and everything. So the Republicans now and some Democrats are attacking Obama and Kerry, and they're saying, no, we can't negotiate with Iran, okay? They're the really bad people. Netanyahu told us that, you know, right? They're the bad people. At the same moment, those bad people are actually the people fighting ISIS in Iraq, the country we liberated from Saddam Hussein, who didn't have any of them operating when he was there, right? So you have basically, if you were talking to anybody in any walk of life, and they were giving you an explanation like this, like why did the scaffold go down in Portland the other day, right? Or any issue, you know, why is this car safe, or why should I not take this vaccine, any issue. And somebody talked the kind of gibberish that we get on foreign policy, you'd walk away from them. You know, you would just say, what? This is not an adult. This is not a serious person. But think about it, you know. Hillary Clinton helped us liberate Libya from Gaddafi. Gaddafi was a fangless, a toothless tiger right by that point. He was actually even cooperating with the West. So we get rid of Gaddafi, and Libya is a holy mess now, literally, okay? We do the same thing with Assad in Syria. We do the same thing with Hussein in Iraq. In Egypt, we finally had a movement, a mass movement for elections. We're now back with the generals who've crippled that country forever. I was there during the Six-Day War. I wrote about this stuff after the Six-Day War. I know that history. So we're back with Nasser. We're back with the old crap and corruption and everything. So you look at it and they say, these guys who come to us as experts, trust us. We know what we're doing, right? Okay? And it's a horrible mess. And these often become monsters of our own creation. We recruited those lunatics who went to Afghanistan to fight, you know, against the Soviets, okay. And then none of this would work if we had access to the information. That's what the classification, secrecy, and spying is all about. It's an exercise in intimidation. It's an exercise in keeping us clueless and trusting our leaders. That's what really the whole thing is about, keeping us in our place. Because if you had access to the information, if you didn't have to have the rare whistleblower, if this was routinely declassified, shared with us, you know what? We know most of the time they don't know what they're doing. And that's okay, maybe. We can give them the benefit of that as long as they're trying. The world's a complex place. But instead, we get the systematic distortion, lying, withholding of information, right? And we get bad decisions made. So my bottom line thing is they're not making us safer. They're making it a more dangerous world, and because it's a world in which there's no accountability over those who have power. Period. End of story.